efficiency. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Manmohan Singh, Mr. Ahluwalia, Professor Stern, Arvind, Mrs. Ahluwalia, Rajat, friends. This is the paper I've always wanted to write. And for many years, I have had this dream, and I'm very glad that I'm at least here to comment on that dream as seen by somebody else. Putting scenarios together with the kinds of policies that are needed, and looking at what are, in a sense, the key challenges in taking it forward, I think is an important area of discussion for us and will continue to be for the many reasons that have been said. Like previous speakers, I do believe that looking at our energy sector from the domestic point of view of ensuring adequate and affordable energy supply to all, and from the global perspective of ensuring that our carbon emissions continue to decline, or at least the intensity declines over time, is of crucial importance. The challenge, of course, is how do we meet all of these objectives together. What I'd like to do is to focus, as Arvind did, a little bit on the scenarios, not too much, but then focus much more on the discussion on policy, and finally on my suggestions, which the authors could take into consideration in looking at the in the summary chapter on overcoming the barriers to policy change. On scenarios, the first point that I'd like to make is a need of recognizing the limitations of the framework that has been used. And I would identify two key limitations which I believe are important. The first is that this framework, the IESS framework, looks at growth in a mode in which future growth drivers are based on the growth drivers of the past. Let me tell you what this means. The single largest energy requirement is by the industrial sector. And within industry, it's steel and cement which become the largest. Now, if you look in the model, the demand for steel is largely dependent on, not largely, it is dependent on the patterns of steel demand in the past. So if a growth rate of 5% meant a steel increase of 5%, then in the future, if you have a growth of 5%, there's also steel increase of 5%. Now, as countries develop, as infrastructure is put into place, these multipliers, these coefficients change. They go through an inverted U as time goes by. Consequently, what the model captures is the Indian economy framework as it is now, not necessarily how it will be in the future. I think this provides a limitation, but I think it provides a limitation on the conservative side. I think it projects that energy use would be higher than it probably will be as economic growth occurs. The second limitation that I'd like to highlight is on energy supply. One of the things that, as a country, we've had a problem with is sourcing adequate gas. I am of the opinion that if somehow we had adequate access to adequate and affordable gas, all our energy problems, all our carbon dioxide problems would essentially be solved. But that's clearly not the case. We have neither the access to gas nor access at prices which produce electricity at prices which people are willing and able to pay. Consequently, looking at large increases in gas, you know, the 50 gigawatts, et cetera, that are in the scenarios is, I think, somewhat difficult. However, having said all of this, none of this takes away from the fact that there are options available, policy options available, which would greatly decrease both the carbon emissions on the one hand, but more importantly, provide a framework within which we can provide more affordable and adequate energy to all. Now, the challenge is to link box 9 with the scenario numbers that have been done prior to that. In a sense, the suggestions of box 9 are those which I think the people in this room can come up with even without the calculations. But that's largely because each one of us has done these calculations in our own heads. What this provides is an analytical framework. But then what is needed is, as Arvind suggested, a prioritization. Which of these leads to the most cost-effective emission reductions, energy reductions? That, I think, would be a signal contribution to the literature in this area. There are, in my view, two other policy challenges. One is the choice of instruments. The choice of instruments, as in box 9, really limit ourselves to two. One is regulatory action, and the other, to some extent, is pricing action. Now, I think the paper rightly notes that it's beyond the scope to go into each of these actions. That's correct. I mean, that's each one of those is a monograph in its own right. But I think what is important is what kinds of instruments make sense for what kind of policy barrier. Clearly, the kinds of policy instruments that you need to address energy efficiency in industry would be very different from the policy instruments one would use to promote renewable energy. A feeling of the appropriateness of those policy instruments is important. But I would argue, I would suggest that there is one more policy action that I think needs to be captured. And for the lack of a better word, I call it policy-led market creation. What does that mean? If you look at renewables in this country, the creation has really been through a series of policy actions, principally the requirement in the Electricity Act that a certain percentage of the electricity in each state is drawn from renewable sources of energy. More recently, we have had, I believe, a great example of this in the area of LED lighting, where the emphasis has been on a company which was created, Energy Efficiency Services Limited, which gets into an agreement with electricity distribution companies. So EESL buys the LED bulbs and provides them to you and I as consumers. And you and I in the city of Delhi have been able to get LED bulbs at a price, I think, of 93 rupees, as opposed to going to the market and getting it today at something of the order of 180 or 200 rupees of a similar quality. Now, why did this happen? This happened, and I emphasize, the business model. The business model was that EESL bought all the bulbs, but bought them after it had an aggregate demand. So what it did was at aggregated demand. When it procured in bulk, the prices fell. And the prices fell from 310 rupees for an LED bulb in January 2014 down to about, I think, 66 rupees 2 weeks ago. This is a dramatic decline and shows us the power of policy-led market creation. Now, I think the time is coming ripe when retail prices of LED bulbs would be equal to or less than that of CFLs. And that's the time when this policy intervention can be retired. But the point that I'd like to leave on the table is that for a very large number of interventions that are being talked about, particularly technology-based interventions, a market creation mechanism is needed. Table 10 talks of the fact that the total savings that occur are actually greater than the total costs that are put in. This makes sense. But obviously, as was pointed out, there is a problem of time. The costs are put in first, they are front-loaded, and the benefits come over a period of time. What the LED model tells us is that it is possible to have business models which make this transition possible. This leads me to my third and final point, which is that, as Nick mentioned, is that of financing. Now, in financing, what matters is not the total cost, but the delta. I mean, after all, money is going to go into energy no matter what. So can the delta be an investment? It earns a return. My suggestion is that in a very large number of instances, particularly all the energy efficiency instances, it does. Whether it is the LEDs or in future ACs and fans, or whether it is the energy efficient buildings that were talked about. If that is the case, how do we move ahead? Cost of financing is a key issue. If internationally finance is available at 3% or 4%, and if the domestic rate of lending is 12 or 13%, the difference provides us an opportunity for seeing how the capital, how the cost of capital in India can be reduced. I mean, one, you see, the argument is that the difference is the hedging cost. It's the cost at which the rupee moves versus the dollar. But the hedging costs that are available today are available for relatively small time periods. There are no 10 or 25 year hedging markets that are available. Is it worth creating them? Is it worth asking whether the global carbon negotiations look at seeing how they can be used to guarantee, I'm not saying subsidized, to guarantee a hedging mechanism so that a lower cost of capital is available? I think we need to look at innovative solutions. To end, what we are looking at are interventions that can, and probably if put into place, will change the trajectory of energy demand and growth, and therefore of CO2 emissions. Policy is important, but I think equally important is the actions you and I take. We, each one of us, has invested, for example, in LED bulbs. What will it take each one of us to invest in a rooftop solar? Some of us have. Others, if we have an appropriate policy framework which allows a business model to come to my doorstep and provide me with the complete door-to-door or end-to-end comfort in putting up such a system, I would probably do it. And since the vast bulk of infrastructure in this country is yet to be made, whether it is in industry or in buildings, energy generation or energy use, I think we have an opportunity. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mathur. I'm now going to invite the authors to come on to the stage here, and we are going to open the session for question and answers. I would request everyone to identify themselves, and please be brief in your question or comment. So may I just open for questions? Yes, please. Udhar dijiye mic.
Hello. I am Satpal Sharma, a retired naval officer. I have one small question regarding appropriateness of the policy not coping up with the new technologies. For instance, Dr. Manmohan, Dr. Ahluwalia mentioned that policies should be clear for 25 years. Actually, now new technologies are available in solar power, which have a lifespan of 70 years. And for last 1 year, the company is trying to sign the PPA with the government for 70 years. Nobody knows how to go about it.
Thank you. I should actually ask the authors if you would like to respond to the comments made by the discussants. Perhaps you could do that first, and then we could open for the... So who would like to go first?
Nick?
So would you like to come here and speak, or would you like to speak from there? Okay. Maybe it's easier for people to see you if you come here.
I'll take a few of the points, and then we'll go on to Montek and Himanshu. And I want to reply generically rather than point by point, because I benefited enormously from the discussants' comments and took lots of notes about what we should do next and how to revise. But there was one set of comments which actually relates to the question that's just been asked about policy and finance. How do they combine? Now, we've argued that there are enormous investment opportunities out there in terms of the kinds of energy-related and infrastructure investments that are now possible and necessary. But investment opportunities are not the same thing as investment programs. And you have to translate an investment opportunity into an investment program by people deciding to make investments. And they decide to make investments on the back of policies and the investment climate, how they think of the nature of the environment, investment environment, where they will work. That includes everything from pricing and regulation and city planning, all the way through to how often you get a malevolent visitation from some officer. That's the whole range in, let's put policy around all that, because bureaucratic intervention, oft sometimes justified, sometimes not, is a big part of the investment environment. So what we have to think about is how to put policies in place which give some confidence. Now, certainty is not on offer. The world isn't like that. But you can have less uncertainty, and our objective should be to bring, through the policy environments we create, through the investment climate that we create, less uncertainty. So how can you do that? Well, a credible city plan can give you some context for transport and infrastructure investment. Regulations, where they're credible, can be very good at bringing confidence. We moved as a world from leaded to unleaded petrol, largely as a result of regulation. But it was clear where we were going, and it was clear that the scale in the future had to be, and indeed all of it had to be eventually, in unleaded, and we went there. And Ajay spoke about LEDs. There was a very clear, other people have done it through regulation, that you shall not do incandescent light bulbs after a certain time, or you move away from the CFLs. But some kind of regulation, in this case, the bulk buying example that Ajay gave. These are the kinds of things, all the way from the more macro environment of the design of the city to regulation, regulations on renewable fractions. Those are the kind of big picture stories, down to the particular interventions around particular things. And partly regulation can bring more confidence, partly city design can bring more confidence. But also, I think, the presence of who is in the partnership. And if you have a local development bank or a multilateral development bank or both in the partnership, then that, in a sense, bridges the policy side and the finance side, because the finance side is more forthcoming because its presence brings the reduction in the policy risk. So you have to have both policy and finance. In a sense, the policy, the policy comes first, because you have to translate investment opportunities into investment demand, but they are actually wound up together. But it's, I agree with both of our discussants, emphasize that point very strongly and surely rightly, and we would, I hope, agree with that. Let me say something about international. I too am unimpressed by what rich countries would do, and I spend far more time haranguing them than discussing. I harangue them, but I discuss in, try to be a discussant and a partner in developing countries, and I've worked particularly in India and China. I think pressing them is very good. I think showing the example that you've taken, India, Indonesia, Mexico have used big, important countries, have used the opportunity of the falling oil price to essentially act in a way that does not reduce the market price by as much, or not at all, and that way starts to introduce the tax and the kind of carbon tax that Arvind described. So in this sense, India, Indonesia, Mexico, and others have set an example to the rich countries, and we use it, and we draw their attention to that. So I think that is very important, but I do think that we're starting to see the rich countries move, but move in a way that's in partnership. And I think the two innovation initiatives that came around Paris are very important. The Mission Innovation, which was the one led particularly by India and United States, but China, UK, others in, 20 countries said they would double their clean investment over the next few years in R&D, clean R&D for energy investment. And that, I think, is a very important part of the story. And the second one was the one I already mentioned in what I have to say, is the global solar initiative, which was led particularly by India. So India has played and 120 countries in that, I think. So those initiatives, those two, I think are very important, and India has been at the heart of both of them. And that's as it should be. This is a partnership, not first you do this and then you do that. It's doing things together. I think there's a big task in if I may use this metaphor, in holding the feet to the fire. Because we had the announcement at the end of November, right at the beginning of Paris, and as far as I can see, it's gone a bit quiet. Now, I know it's only a month or so, 2 months or so since then, but I think that should be a very strong point of pressure. So I think the innovation side is good. The capital side, expanding the ability to lend of the development banks, I have a specific proposal which I've been developing with Amar Bhattacharya, expanding their ability to lend, the core regional development banks and the World Bank, expanding their ability to lend from 700 billion a year to 200 billion a year would make a very big difference. And I think the countries of the world have to work together to do that. And we have ways which we've concocted of not going to Congress. You know, no one in their right mind would ever go to the US Congress for anything of substance. And you can get around it through ingenious ways of recycling IDA reflows and so on. So I do think that's very important. But I mean, India is such a big country, and the infrastructure investment demands are so large that probably the bigger part of that story of bringing down the cost of capital will be in India itself, although with participation. And I think inevitably, to some extent, that will mean sovereign guarantees for certain kinds of loans. And so be it, in my view. So I've tried to speak about policy and finance, the international side, I think, around innovation and capital. But it's not just innovation and capital. It's also pressing hard on examples. You rich countries, you've got more in the way of technology. You come up with more examples that we can all use. So keeping up the pressure on that. Finally, you mentioned, Arvind, that you have, through your responses to the falling energy prices, started to put on what are essentially, what look like, act like carbon taxes. And my only request would be to do the same for coal, but you might want to call it a pollution tax. So obviously your comments were very rich and I can't cover them all, and certainly would leave to Montek Ajay's point about tighter linkages between the policies and the changing coefficients and what might happen. I do think that's very important. And we've taken a 30-year horizon, so the request to work a bit on what comes next, what comes first, and the prioritization amongst them is a very fair request also. We started with the long period, big picture story, but for policy, you have to dive down and get into the details and what comes first, and that seems to be a very fair comment which tells us what to do next. So, thank you.
Before I ask Montek Ahluwalia to speak, I'll request our board member, Dr. Kiran Mazumdar-Shaw. She has a comment or a question.
Yeah, I just picked up on three very important comments that were made by Nick and Arvind and Ajay. I think you talked about innovation and technology. I think Arvind brought up a very important point about how do you tax polluters and the carbon footprint that you create in a better way. And I think Ajay talked about disruptions, because I really agree with him that the kind of graphs that are being drawn up are based on the past. And you have to really find a way of providing for future disruptive technologies, otherwise you could really be wrong when you start forecasting. Now, the question I wanted to suggest was, you know, everyone talks about, investing in innovation, investing in new technologies, but you need to create a virtuous cycle of investment. And I think this is an area where I think the taxes that you levy on whatever the oil price is coming down, and therefore you can take advantage of that. Can we not, you know, put that kind of tax into innovation? I mean, I think that would create the kind of virtuous cycle that could really come up with, you know, disruptive technologies that could find you have a very different graph.
Oops. Thank you. Well, first of all, thanks to the discussants and the questions so far. As I had said right at the beginning, this is a work in progress, and we are actually going to absorb a lot of what you've said. So some very brief reactions. You know, I completely agree with, I want to clarify, Arvind rightly said that the terrible thing about Box 9 is it looks like such a large number of things on the agenda that it tempts people to say that what we are saying is if all this can't be done, it's no use, therefore it can't be done, so therefore let's forget it. That is not at all the intention. I mean, the paper itself will make clear that the purpose of Box 9 was to say it isn't one thing. Although if you were to ask me in terms of prioritization, which is absolutely correct, and I think you'd also agree with this, energy pricing is the single most important thing, regulation is the next most important thing. Then what I think Box 9 says is there's a whole set of things that's kind of mutually supportive. So assume you are sitting in a government meeting and you have Box 9, and people say, well, look, there are 8 intervention areas. For the moment, can we forget about the last 3? And let's just focus on these. Well, that would be an improvement. What the purpose of Box 9, as it will be written up, is that in those 3, it's better to do a set of mutually supportive things than just do one here and one somewhere else and so on. And for example, take urban transportation. Clearly, some sort of mutually supportive intervention about metros, about public transport, clearly involves more investment. If you can move in due course to, let's say, a regulation which says today that 10 years from now, the only taxis that will be allowed in Delhi will be electric. Now, you can't do that saying tomorrow because they don't produce them. But if you gave clarity that 10 years from now, it's going to be electric, then I think people would be willing to respond. you'd have an interesting question. Would they be domestically made, or could they be imported, or could they be foreign companies that set up, whatever the rules are. I give you the most, for example, ticketing. There's no reason why, in a world of smart transport, you shouldn't have a card which you can use for both the metro and the bus service, if you're going to move from metro to bus in a seamless manner. One interesting case which I came across, and I think it figures in a joint piece that Ajay and I wrote, that, you know, if you want to get, in a world in which cities are not perceived yet in India to be safe for women, particularly if it's kind of evening hours, whatever you do on public transport, the woman is going to use her private car unless the movement from the bus stop to her home is reasonably assured, the route is well lit, and it's policed. So, I mean, all the guys who think about transport planning typically don't think about this. So that was really the idea, but I take the point that we're not saying for 1 minute that everything has to be done, but we're just saying it's not one thing, it's a lot of things. Yes, we should prioritize, but let's prioritize in a mutually supporting way. I think that's the main point I want to make. You know, Kiran made a very important point. How do we incentivize innovation? I mean, this is where 90% of the suggestions that I'm sure the finance minister is getting right now is how to subsidize innovation. The essence of what we're saying is, please put a tax on carbon, and I agree with her entirely, use it either to do immediate corrections, like, for example, subsidizing bus transport, or subsidizing the kind of innovation that will reduce costs. Your point, Arvind, about clean coal is very crucial. It's there in the paper somewhere, although it didn't come out here. I mean, we should not rule out technological breakthroughs in cleaning coal. There's nothing wrong with coal if you can clean it. My understanding is, at the moment, not much has happened. But, you know, if we can get the industrialized countries to put a tax on dirty coal and use the revenues to subsidize the innovation for cleaning coal, see, it's very crucial that a mechanism that actually uses the coal in a clean way, either because it cleans the coal or it takes care of the pollution, the additional tax should somehow get rebated. Now, those are structures where, quite frankly, it is the industrialized world that can lead. I mean, they have larger systems, more efficient systems, and we would then follow. Nick mentioned Dr. Manmohan Singh's intervention in the Heiligen Dam summit, which said, look, don't worry about us, we'll always be below your per capita income. You know, per capita emissions. Underlying that is an interesting point, that the obligations imposed on developing countries should be a function of what the developed countries actually do. Because the truth is, if the developed countries really go down big time, that's a big opportunity for everybody else, providing we're willing to change. So the purpose of this paper is really to raise issues. We will improve it. Thank you for the comments. I mean, there may be lots of other interesting things. Yes, railways, since we may be getting the railway minister. Maybe I should wait on railways until he comes. And cost of solar, a very, very important point that Arvind made, that he'd like to know what is the state of play in the cost of solar. There is work being done. A lot of what you hear, which says levelized cost of solar is now equal to, is actually misleading. I mean, for the simple reason that solar is an intermittent supply source. So since the grid has to supply power at a pretty even pace, it's not much use telling the grid that here's something that is going to give you a humongous amount of power, but only in the daytime, and somehow for the rest you have to use something else. In the paper, we do mention that the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory has done a lot of work synchronizing solar with wind complementarities. And they say that actually if we went big time, and the government has in fact announced the targets, and if we do implement them, seasonally and intraday and so on, there is a certain amount where when the wind is available, the solar is not, etc. That is important. But there's absolutely no doubt that if you want to get a steady supply based on a high degree of intermittent supply, you will need to put in balancing equipment. I think somewhere 140 gigawatts by the end of 2047, just for balancing. In other words, it'll come into play when the solar doesn't come into play. So, you know, when you do the cost, the levelized cost of solar is very, very misleading because it doesn't build in the cost that would be required to put in balancing equipment, plus the cost of upgrading the grid. The grid has to be managed hugely more smartly than it is being done now. And that raises the question that the way our grid systems and all this are organized, are they capable of bringing in the most efficient technology? I mean, I'm sure we have the people, but these are all run like government departments. So the chances that they will actually do what is meant to be done without structural change is actually doubtful. Now, I think I'll say my bit on railways, and that is I completely agree with what Arvind has said, that other than energy prices, investment in railways, in my view, would be the highest priority that we should have out of that box number 9. But you know, you have to remember that if you're going to do that, it should be combined with some structural change in how the railways is both organized and railway pricing. I've seen somewhere that if you construct an index of how much we are overcharging freight and undercharging passengers, we are 5 times as distorted as China. So if you want freight to move to the railways, we have to cut down the excess charge of freight. If excess charge of freight has to be cut down, then the passengers must pay for themselves, or the finance ministry must pay for them. I would not be in favor of subsidizing railway passengers. It can't be done in one go. But we need some clarity that maybe in the next 5 years or 6 years, this is what's going to happen. And I think this is one very big doable thing. I'd hope that the railway minister would be here so that we can hand over to him to comment. But I just want, I'll tell him, maybe Isha can tell him, that we have emphasized railways. I think other than that, I agree with a lot of what Ajay said, the idea of creating a market, regulations that create markets. You know, one of the issues there is it can become an inter-regional issue. For example, you say that you have got to buy 5% of the electricity or 10% of the electricity from renewable sources. Now, the renewable sources are all going to come from Rajasthan or from Karnataka. From a national point of view, it's good to pay a premium price. But you raise this issue that somebody in Madhya Pradesh or somebody in Bihar might say, my consumers are bearing the cost of subsidizing producers in a totally different state. Well, the short answer is it is one country, there are a lot of linkages, but these are issues that need to be debated much more. And I think this paper is only meant to trigger a debate so that people can start thinking about some of these things.
Thank you. Himanshu, would you like to?
Yeah,
comment?
Say your stuff on the U-curve.
I'll hold you. Well, we are now joined by the Honorable Minister for Railways, Shri Suresh Prabhu. Welcome, Suresh Ji, and thank you very much for making it. Before we do anything else, I'd request Dr. Rajat Kathuria to felicitate the minister. You have chosen your entry very appropriately. We have just finished with the presentations, the discussants, comments from Dr. Arvind Subramanian and Dr. Ajay Mathur, and a response from the speakers here, Lord Nixon, Montek, Ahluwalia, and Himanshu Gupta. And Montek was the last speaker here, where as I understand it, what they emphasized in terms of the priority areas for action, if we have to move towards a more sustainable energy strategy for India, first was energy pricing, and second was a range of things that they have pointed out in their paper and on railways, which the executive summary was also sent to you because we realized that you were going to be coming in late. So you have seen what they are saying on railways in the executive summary. And what we would like you to do is to make some observations reacting to the what you have seen in the summary of the paper, and then we'll ask the authors to come back to say a few words after you. Please.
So good afternoon, friends. It's pretty embarrassing to speak when such stalwarts are sitting here, our former prime minister sitting here, some of our two distinguished people are here, and I can see many others sitting behind. But the politicians are known for taking risks, so I'm taking a risk of speaking. Very interestingly, the energy scenario of the world had changed suddenly. There was a time when, just a few years ago, there was a global discussion about how some of the countries in the world are not doing the pricing of the energy products in a domestic market in at line with the global market. Some of us, including me, was of the opinion that if the global markets are truly functioning markets, not necessarily cartelized, work on the basis of free flow of demand and supply, then there could be a strong argument in support of saying that there should not be a subsidy element and the domestic pricing should be at par with the global prices. But as now it has been proved, and suddenly things have changed, that global prices have fallen dramatically, and now that discussion has taken a backseat. Even I know Dr. Montek, Singh, Ahluwalia, when he was representing a prime minister in G20 SHEPA meetings, you would be hearing this discussion, which also I had to keep following it up when I was, but difficult to succeed him, but still managed to, and were doing it for a while. So now three very interesting things have changed the world suddenly. One, as I said, the global prices have fallen. Then one of the top investment bankers of the world was saying it's only a matter of time when they'll just reach $200 per barrel. And now they are even saying that it's not just time, but it would touch any time $20 a barrel. So just imagine, the best investment banker of the world has really taken a dramatic turn in terms of forecasting, where it is going from $200 to $20. But that has dramatically changed. So this is one global trend which is suddenly affecting everybody. Something similar on these lines has happened in Paris. Nobody was expecting that we'll get a deal. And now we have a framework of working on climate change. And this is a much very interesting development, because we are thinking what's going to succeed Kyoto Protocol, whether UNFCCC will really remain in its total form. And as Dr. Stern has been pointing out, that delaying action is more expensive. Taking action at the right time may be still possible to save the world. But now I'm not sure whether this agreement will ensure that we remain within the 2 centigrade tolerance limit or beyond. But still we have an agreement. And third, very interestingly, energy markets have changed, climate situation has improved, and suddenly, also not suddenly really, but over a period of time, we have seen a decline in the economic activity of the world. And it looks like 2016 certainly will not be the year when the global economy will turn around. Certainly not. So therefore, lowering of demand, thanks to global energy market, global economy, the sudden supply, which has increased thanks to geopolitical situation which has happened in the world, and also the dramatic fall in the oil prices, and now the huge requirement, and also even if it is not a legally binding commitment in Paris, still everybody has given a national commitment, and therefore how do you reduce the emission in line with what is required as per the Paris Convention is three important dimensions. And in that, I think one of the countries which will be playing a very significant role, which can shape and in a way alter these scenarios in a significant way, is India. Because International Energy Agency has been always been saying, even before these three new developments I mentioned, that India will be the single largest users of incremental use of energy in the world. And therefore, India's role is going to be very critical. And now, we already committed to make about 100,000 megawatts of solar, 70,000 megawatts of wind, and that's why we'll be probably the single largest country which will be contributing significantly to the new renewable energy portfolio of the world. And therefore, in that context, we have to see how we really work on these scenarios. So of course, Dr. Montek Singh Ahluwalia has done a phenomenal job. I was reading his paper, and you already drawn from some of the ideas, some of the new module that has been produced by NITI Aayog. And therefore, I think I agree that we have a great opportunity. We can actually work on it. But as we are saying, as was thing in the past, despite the fact that energy scenario has changed so much, that what we do in India in energy will be significantly determined by what happens globally. For example, if you want to increase our solar portfolio to a level of 100,000, the global solar market, how it's going to react to this, will have a huge bearing on this, our priorities. Today, the prices are at rock bottom. If we do not get technological breakthroughs of improving the photovoltaic efficiency level going beyond 20-25% very soon, we do not at the same time get technological innovation in terms of energy storage in a significant manner, I don't know how prices will behave in solar portfolio. And therefore, if these global breakthroughs happen, and which could happen, this is absolutely a great possibility of that happening. Already the Paris actually is a very good turning point to make that happen sooner than later. And therefore, if that happens, India would be the single largest beneficiary and could scale it up. Another very interesting initiative of a prime minister, which can also alter the scenario in a significant way, and that's International Solar Alliance. Then recently, we also set up its international headquarters in Gurgaon. And therefore, the International Solar Alliance also makes it possible to bring down the prices of solar power in a very significant way. Because if all those countries who have got a radiation, who have got a potential to make solar energy, who have 300 days of sunshine, if they all call giant hands and say that we are definitely going to generate so much of solar energy in the next 10, 20 years, it will send strong signals to the market, which markets will pick up and invest into R&D so that this process of bringing efficiency into solar PV as well as solar storage will become a reality very soon. And this is where the international is going to happen in a significant way. So this is a very important scenario. Aishwarya had told me to speak about railways. I mean, suddenly reminded me that I am only a railways minister. So this will also going to alter the scenario. And again, if the global economy picks up in 17 and 18 and 19, a little bit more than what it is today, it might again bring about a change in the fossil fuel prices. But that in turn might help your solar energy. If the competitive fuel prices are going to rise, that will help the renewables and not affect the renewables adversely. So these are the various scenarios which will going to happen. So as she has asked me, the mobility is one of the important users of energy. Whether it is vehicles, the transportation sector is one of the principal contributors to greenhouse gas emission, as well as the users of energy. Particularly, as we are seeing urbanization, and as the urbanization is growing, the urban transport is going to play a significant role in terms of consuming energy. It will also be one of the single contributors for energy. In fact, Delhi's pollution is largely because of vehicular traffic, besides others, but largely. And therefore, transportation is going to be important in that railways will be one of the key players of deciding how we reduce the emission coming out of the mobility and particularly the transport sector. Railways are known to be far better users of energy as opposed to the vehicular traffic. And therefore, railways should be preferred mode of transportation, as has always been advocated by my good friend, Dr. Arvind Subramanian, even in his last economic survey. And that's what our direction is clear. To invest into railways is making sure that we invest into the future of India, also in making sure that we invest into a cleaner India future. So that's why it is absolutely important. But if you use only fuel in railway, it is obviously better than vehicles, but not necessarily will be the best mode of transportation from the emission perspective. If you don't change the energy profile of railway itself, it is like using electric car, which may look like a very good option, but electricity is coming from coal, then it is not a good option at all. And therefore, unless you change the energy profile of the railway itself, it is not going to significantly improve the emission profile. And therefore, we have decided to use large portion of renewable energy into the railways. A commitment of at least 1,000 megawatts, and I think now we are revising it upwards, to use all the footprint that are available to the railways. We are going to use all the rooftops. We are going to use even the facade of the new building, which are already been designed in that particular manner. We'll also use the land that is available to the railways. And therefore, solar energy will be at least 1,000 megawatts, if not more, that railways will produce in the next few years' time. In fact, we already signed an agreement with my colleague, Ministry of Power, and we are actually taking a number of steps in that direction. Probably we'll be increasing that target significantly. But also to make sure that our energy footprint is not very high, we have already started energy audits for all the railway operations, and we are going to use more and more energy efficient technologies, whether even in the diesel use. It's not just electricity, the traction power that we use for electricity, but also using it for the domestic use of the diesel power as well. So whether it is the auxiliary use of railway operations and all of that, we'll try to use that more and more. Thirdly, we are also using not just solar, but also the wind energy. We already commissioned the first wind project, wind turbine, in Jaisalmer. And now we are going to use more and more. I had announced in my last budget speech that we'll make at least two waste to energy projects. We already commissioned two, and therefore we like to do even more. But to create critical mass of municipal solid waste, which can make this plant more efficient, more viable, we need to collect all the municipal solid waste together. So we are tying up with the cities so that it can happen in a much better way. So there are a number of these steps which are taken. Energy efficiency is one of the key parameters. Buildings, which are one of the consumers of electricity in a significant way, we are changing it to LED in almost all the buildings in the next few years' time. It's not just railways, but also railway colonies, all other railway establishment. So all of that together will significantly reduce the emission load, and therefore railways will not just remain a preferred mode of transportation as opposed to road, but it will become in absolute numbers as well, reduce the energy intensity, carbon intensity in a significant way in the next few years' time. Even on diesel, we have taken a number of steps. In fact, the Rajdhani from Mumbai to Delhi, I just flagged it off the other day, which is now going to be using far less energy, though it uses diesel, but we are actually going to use it in a completely different mode. So we are using technology, we are using management practices, we are using change energy profile. By doing all this, I am sure in the next few years' time, we'll bring down the electricity use as well as the energy use in railways in a significant way. Though it is not very significant, but doctor, this year, Dr. Saab will be very happy because you have been a great champion of this. We actually will be saving 3,000 to 4,000 crores in the next few years' time, year after year, because we are following these new policies for energy. We have decided to buy electricity from open market. So, railway was the single largest user of energy and was paying the highest price for electricity. So this was completely defying the market logic that a single buyer is paying the highest price. And therefore, we decided to change it. We actually issued a tender. We reduced the cost. So despite the fact that we are suffering because of lack of traffic available, because of the natural resources are not moving as much, we could save cost significantly and therefore improve our operational ratio in a much better way. So I think these are a few of the points. Just last point, if you permit me, and this is really speaking just pertaining to all of us, is that this, when we talk about renewables, we obviously talk about solar, we talk about wind, we talk about waste to energy, we talk about biomass and many others. I think one of the things is solar. When we talk about solar, we only focus on photovoltaic. I think it's a time we also must focus our attention on solar thermal. And to make solar thermal work, we have a huge potential in Gujarat and Rajasthan. That's a desert. But Dr. Stern, you will tell us this, that many of my friends in technology say that we need to run the turbine, we need a lot of water. But I think By definition, a place is called desert because there is no water. And the highest potential for solar thermal is in desert. So how do you do it? So I think we should really invest into technology so that we can generate more of solar thermal without using water. And that could be significant. Again, countries like India going to be the largest user of energy. So you must tie up with countries like Japan, which you're already doing. Thanks to the previous government, which we are carrying it forward. We have a strategic partnership with that country. So using hydrates, using the energy at subsea level, bringing it up, using it in a right manner, could also transform the energy scenario, not just of India, but of the world in the due course of time. So thank you very much for this opportunity. I will try to be contributing in whatever other manner that is necessary to make this happen. Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask if Lord Stern and Montek Ahluwalia would like to say a few things in response to what the minister has said. Would you like a couple of minutes to?
Thank you very much, Suresh, for being able to be with us today. We greatly appreciate both your coming and what you had to say. If I could just make one comment right at the end, which links to the comments you made earlier on, and Montek already mentioned it, and that is how we make the renewables much more part of a system without putting a very heavy load on the rest of the system in terms of adapting to the intermittency. And the last point you made about solar thermal is actually a way of doing that, because solar thermal carries its own storage. You use the solar energy to heat up something. That something is an issue for research. I mean, molten salt, for example, is one way of doing it. There may be other ways of doing it also. And the next step is to transform the solar thermal into electricity, because you store it as the heat, and then you have to translate that heat into the electricity. Now, the conventional measure is to do it by powering a steam engine, essentially, and for that, you need the water. But you don't need the water for storing the heat, because you can use something else, and we have to see whether we can make the storage, the conversion of that heat into electricity, less intensive on water. But you can do it in an equal way to coal, because coal converts the its own thermal energy into electricity through heating water. So it would already, in any case, be on a par with that, but there is a question as to whether we can do much better. Secondly, on I'll leave most of the railway and the close, Montek knows much more about the structure of the railways than I do, but I would heartily agree with the focus on using less energy, but also on electrification. But also, you went the extra step, quite rightly, I think, in saying that electrification has to be supplied by plants which are non-polluting. And finally, I would emphasize the integration of different forms of transport, the ability to switch quickly from railway to bus or railway to metro makes a very big difference in the whole story. And indeed, from railway to airports. You finally have the railway going to the airport in Delhi, and over time, that should make a very big difference. So the only point I would add on that is the importance of the integration of the different forms of transport, particularly in the context of cities that are growing very rapidly. But thank you very much again for coming. Oh, one thing, I wanted to echo what was said about Ajay's leadership in Paris, and that it was mentioned earlier, but I saw it in action, and Prakash Javarekar and Ajay Mathur set the tone following Prime Minister Modi's leadership, and I wanted to take the opportunity of being on the stage to thank you, Ajay, and please also thank Prakash again for that leadership. Thank you.
Montek, before we ask you to speak, we have one intervention from the floor. Gajendra Haldia.
Thank you, ma'am. I just want to raise two issues. One is about energy. Energy efficiency is very important in this whole context, as we all know. Now, India has been focusing on power reforms in different ways, but the one central theme which is completely missing is creating efficient markets that respond to demand and supply impulses. It's hard to believe, but the fact is that almost 3.5 lakh crores worth of electricity is procured every year in India, almost all of which is bought by the government or government-owned agencies. There's no market whatsoever. And we are failing to have, to bring any change even in the foreseeable future. There isn't enough debate about it. So if you want to fix energy, one important aspect of it is to create a vibrant and effective electricity market. That's point number one. Mm-hmm. The second point I want to make is about railways. And fortunately, the railway minister is here. In the last 4 or 5 years, between planning commission, the erstwhile planning commission and the railway ministry, a lot of frameworks were built in order to promote a rapid infusion of private investment in the railway sector. I must compliment the railway minister for using one such framework in getting General Electric to invest in India and produce diesel locomotives, and Alstom of France to produce electric locomotives. This is one big initiative which is formed part of the Make India campaign, and it was evolved by the Planning Commission 4 years ago. There are several such frameworks which can really help him in ramping up investment and expanding the capacity of railways in the next 2 or 3 years. And I really expect that in the next budget, we will see a list of these initiatives concretized and implemented within specific time frames. Thank you.
Thank you, Gajendra. Montek.
Well, I think Nick has already mentioned that our paper is entirely in line with what the railway minister said about the importance of electrification. In fact, earlier on I had said that the only way in which renewables can actually be brought in is if we electrify massively. So I was delighted to hear both your emphasis on electrification and also the direct purchase of solar and other kinds of renewable energy. Very good, very, very important initiative. You know, on Gajendra's point about having a market for electricity, I mean, I absolutely agree that, you know, if we are doing all this, then probably the single biggest market distortion on the electricity side is that the electricity market doesn't function like a market. I think for several years, previous government, and I'm sure this government also has been trying to get open access implemented. State governments, the state government distribution companies have been resisting it. And it's true that if energies are important, B, we're changing the structure of within electricity, we're going to have more electricity rather than other energy, and within electricity, we're going to have different sources. I mean, a serious getting rid of market distortions that prevent sensible outcomes is very crucial. So, I mean, it's a big agenda, but I certainly agree that that is important. One small thing that Ajay mentioned, you know, I agree with you that all these long-term projections invariably tend to look as if they're a continuation of the past. I think Kiran also made that point. Of course, this is a Niti Aayog calculator, is not the calculator we've invented, but to be fair, they have built-in structural change. You know, the BAU does not assume a proportional increase in cement and steel. What I think is probably true is that it takes into account less change than there's going to be. Because the basis of determining how much change there is has been really talking to current sectoral experts. And I mean, the truth is, who would have thought 25 years ago what is going to happen to the internet and mobile and so on? So even the current experts really do not know. And Nick made that point, and it's extremely important that in our view, we think that technology will change a lot faster than anyone is thinking right now. But you know, from a policy point of view, you need to be nimble and willing to respond.
I mean, the real danger is that policy has changed, everybody else has changed, but our systems are frozen so that we are not able to benefit from the change in technology that takes place. And that is something that the government of the day has to be constantly watchful about.
You want to say a word?
I just wanted to support this point that you mentioned about the absence of electricity market and the contributing reasons towards it. I mean, one of the reasons is the states, because we have to get them on board. We must make sure, because states really play a dominant role in the electricity sector. But I think, and I have very fond memories of that, we worked together as a team to bring states completely on board. We signed a tripartite agreement, and that was really a good partnership between the Planning Commission then, and as he was a member, I was a Minister of Power, and we do that. I think this is a good time to do that again, because as we have seen in UK, when you opened up your electricity market, you started with 1 megawatt of open access, if I recall it correctly. Dr. Haldia will tell, says 1 megawatt. So I think we started with that. When we were drafting this Electricity Act, one of the challenges we had was that the demand was far in excess of the supply. Now, thanks to the act itself, now we have more generating capacity than the demand. So we have excess supply than demand. So it's a good time to introduce this open access, which will bring down the prices, which will also incentivize the state to work on it. So I think this is a good time to actually introduce, make this intervention, and make it happen. States also will be happy. I think one of the things that we really need to work out is the state need not lose anything. We can tell that wherever the open access is going to come, this will come into the areas which the state feel that they can just dispense with. So excess capacity, why would then the capacity which has created will go there? Because they are also finding it difficult to sell the electricity. So I think there will be a win-win situation, and we really need to work out such models.
No, no, I think that's absolutely right. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I just would say, just add two things. One is just that apart from all the, I mean, just the fact of investment in railways and rectifying the current imbalance on freight, which is now 30-60 in favor of road and 60 for road and 30 for railways, whereas the international norm is exactly the reverse. And just rectifying that will have a huge impact in addition to all the other things that the minister said. The second thing I think the minister is being a little coy about, and it connects all this, is that, correct me if I'm wrong, Minister, that the agreement that the minister has entered into on power, in fact, is open access for the railways for power. So in that sense, it's on the cutting edge of, you know, the railways are, as a buyer, they can buy from any state without any cross-subsidy charges. The railways has become, is in the vanguard of creating open access and power.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely. Mind you, the railways vis-a-vis the states have a lot of bargaining power. So I don't see the states trying to deny open access to the railways. We need to spread that much more broadly. And I think, frankly, I think the solution really, if Minister, you can consider, effective implementation of open access without any restriction could be made a condition of benefiting from the Ujjwal scheme. So if it is there, that's very good. We just have to see, somebody says it's not there. But okay, so I would strongly recommend any initiative that makes that so. It would help hugely.
I can't tell you about the survey.
Well, you've told me in that case. No, no, are you saying you're going to say it in the survey? No, no, that doesn't matter. The survey has always said sensible thing. Just get it done.
If there are no other pressing interventions from the floor, I would now like to request Dr. Kathuria to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Ishar. You will all agree that this has been a most stimulating couple of hours. And I would like to thank Nick, Montek, and Himanshu for a rich, thought-provoking, and erudite presentation. Nick, as he said in his opening remarks, has been a very keen observer for India and has been coming to India for the last 4 decades. Montek, as you all know, has been an architect of India's economic reforms. And Himanshu, as Ishar said in the beginning, is a budding scholar at Stanford University, and I think with a very, very bright future ahead of him. Thank you, Arvind Subramanian, for taking the time off from the pressing task of writing the economic survey, for which, as you know, he set a very high benchmark for himself last year, and hope you can better it this year. Grateful to Ajay, a key member, as Nick said, of India's climate team, and also to the minister, Shri Suresh Prabhu, for cutting short an engagement and coming here and showing us that railways can indeed lead India's decarbonation drive. To the chairperson and all the board members present here, thank you very much for all the support that you've given to ICRIER. We really value it, and we know that we can always fall back on you in times of need. To Team ICRIER and the London School of Economics Observatory, thank you for the collaboration and hope we can do more such successful events in the future. And finally, to all of you present here for making this seminar a grand success, and a special thanks to our former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, as Isha said, one of ICRIER's founder members. Thank you so much for your presence here. And on ICRIER's part, I can commit that we will continue to work on urbanization, on climate change, and building those connected, coordinated, and compact cities so that we can reduce our carbon footprint. We will continue to provide ammunition, knowledge to the policymakers that they can use. I know it's a hard balance to create between GDP and emissions. It's a hard balance, but we will continue to provide that knowledge so that this hard balance can translate into actual policy in the future. And finally, could you please all join me in giving a healthy round of applause. It's a Freudian slip. To the speakers, and please do stay for lunch following your round of applause.